public start, thank you for your attendance at this September edition of Standards and Constitutional Oversight. We have quite a busy agenda this evening. Before we get going, can everyone just check that your phones are either on silent or turned off so we don't get any disturbances, please? I'm trusting you. Yeah, you're all done. You've done this before, haven't you? Okay, so first of all, is there any apologies for absence? I think everyone's here. Item 2 on the agenda. Members, declarations of interest. I'm sure everyone's on site of the agenda. Is there anything anyone would like to declare? No? That was easy enough. Okay. Item 3 on the agenda is the minutes, which is page 1 to 10 on your agenda. I did find one slight error which has been amended. Chris was getting the deputy whether he wanted it or not. It's actually Moira, whether she wants it or not. So that's it, we amended it. Anything else anyone else has come up with? No? It's too easy, making it easy for me. Yeah, let's sign that. Item 4, which is the constitutional arrangements for the operation of the Northern Local Government Pension Scheme Investment Pool, which is page 11 to 60 on your agenda. And for that we have Peter.
Yes, thank you, Chair. The report seeks the approval of the committee for the constitutional arrangements that Pension Committee, this meeting on the 16th of July, recommended to the full council in order to implement the requirements imposed on administering authorities for local government pension schemes by the investment regulations and also guidance from the Secretary of State to establish arrangements with other local government pension funds to pool investments in order to oversee greater efficiency and economise on costs for investment management. To explain, there are 89 local government pension schemes around the UK. Merseyside is the 5th largest local government pension scheme. Back in 2016, government mandated that local government pension schemes needed to work together to pool their investments. And as a consequence of that, 8 different investment pools have been set up in England and Wales. Merseyside Pension Fund is working with both Greater Manchester Pension Fund and West Yorkshire Pension Fund to form what is grandly called the Northern LGPS. And in order to comply with guidance issued by the Secretary of State, we're needing to establish a joint committee. That joint committee has been operating in shadow form for the last 2 years while we pull arrangements of the pool together. But as the report sets out, there is an operating agreement which is attached as an appendix to the report, which sets out the way in which the joint committee will operate. There are 4 criteria for pooling. One of those criteria is the government's arrangements, and the Pensions Committee considered the operating agreement at its meeting on the 16th of July and recommended that it should be taken forward to full council. But ahead of that, it's quite right that it's brought to this committee. And that's a very brief overview by me, but the operating agreement effectively establishes a joint committee with 2 representatives from each of the 3 authorities. Those are 2 elected members from each of the 3 authorities, and also 3 member representatives who will be appointed by the trade unions. The operating agreement is quite lengthy. It's in the pack for members to consider. It has been considered by both the Pensions Committee and the local pension board, who scrutinised it and had 2 or 3 observations for me to take forward. So I'm happy to leave it there if that's right, Chair.
Yeah, it's good for me. Before I put it out to the committee, to be honest, Peter, it's more of an operational dealing with the pensions question, which is a pensions question rather than a constitutional question. But it was just something, it seems that you, when you're here, I see that we opted for the officer working group rather than looking at the company option. And is that likely to be the visitors, and what was the reason behind actually looking at setting up a pooling company?
obligations that people have to follow. If friends fall out, we're putting all the books straight, sorting out all the administrative matters and so on. I'm going to draw attention to those in case something were to cause members' concern or this council concern, that the exit procedure is there, but it does require everyone to be very open about the bookkeeping, and also if members are from this council are serving on the body, it looks as though that members have to leave and let them get on with it without really influencing the next course of events. So I'm interested in how we're protected without being too picky.
Two parts to the answer to that, Chair. The individual one, in terms of the member's personal position, which I can't answer, and we can answer the corporate one. So, in terms of the individual one, because this is a joint committee, you are still covered by your indemnity provided by the that modern and up to date document, the Public Health Act 1875, which is what gives members actually indemnity from any personal sanctions. Terms of being sued, criminal or corporate for your functions as a councillor, because this is a joint committee carrying out your functions as a councillor, and therefore you're covered by that indemnity and our insurance.
Sorry, Chair, I haven't made myself quite clear, it's not just individual members.
No, and then
the authority is such.
Yes, so that's part one of the answer.
Thank you very much.
In relation to the pension fund itself, where we have set up joint pooled investments with our partners, and we've done that in two asset classes so far, at the moment other assets are held effectively in a segregated mandate. So there's no uncertainty about the assets that belong to the Merseyside Pension Fund and to the Commission Authority.
just have a lot of folks actually on the recommendation.
Thank you.
Thanks for that. I've got an loss. Very good. Psychological failure. Yeah, so the recommendation is that the Standards and Constitutional Oversight Committee approves the recommendations to the full council that the proposed principles of governance contained in the draft which we've seen operating agreement approved by the Pensions Committee on 16th of July is approved. Is everyone in favour? I will propose it. And they're seconded by all in favour. Against? Abstentions? One abstention. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
It's been a bit of a rewild family page again for the next item. Item 5 on the agenda is on page 61, which is the review of the scrutiny arrangements from the Chair of Business Overview and Scrutiny Committee. I'm very pleased to have Dave here to speak to this particular item. Okay, Dave, what was
you? Thank you very much, Chair. As agreed by the Council on the 14th of May, a review of the current scrutiny arrangements was asked for by Mr. Lagasse of the Business Select Committee. As Chair of the Business Overview and Scrutiny Select, I established a scrutiny review panel and hosted an all members workshop. This report provides the outcomes of the review undertaken by the Business Overview and Scrutiny Committee. It is important to note that this review into scrutiny is undertaken alongside a governance review by the Working Group of Standards Constitution Oversight Committee. The primary objective of the governance review Working Group was to explore different governance options that could be implemented. That's the current system, cabinet, executive body, the committee system, or the potential high-level both sets of arrangements. The governance review, therefore, was had indications of a scrutiny review that some government models do not require scrutiny. Members should note that we are unable to propose an exact scrutiny model, and we were unaware of the outcomes of the governance report until it was published. Further to this, future governance arrangements have not been formalised, so it was not possible to propose where scrutiny would fit within a new model. As part of the scoping review, the review panel asked the scrutiny team to carry out research into the governance and scrutiny arrangements of our statistical neighbours. Scrutiny office also compiled information on councils which had a committee system in place. This was compiled into a brief impact, once approved, distributed to all non-executive members of the council. This is available as an appendix. From that, within the current executive model, there's a statutory requirement for scrutiny arrangements to be in place. The Wirral Company has four scrutiny committees in addition. Three Wirral members sit on the overview of the scrutiny committee of the city combined authority. The report fact contains statutory guidance on overview of scrutiny in local government, which was published by government in May 2019. This is the best practice guide. It was noted that we'll already fulfill several of these areas of focus, which are expanded upon in pages 69 and 70 of this report. It also worth noting that the areas that's needed work on were around organisation and culture. workshop was held on the 17th of July in order to include all the views of public and street members from across political parties and to allow open discussion. This workshop was attended by 11 elected members as well as a key member of the strategic leadership team. The statutory scrutiny officers facilitated the session in order to ensure the objectives were clear and to provide an overview of the current arrangements and key points to be considered as part of the workshop. Workshop activities consisted of two main areas of deliberation: to gain an understanding of the positive areas of the current system and members thought should be included in any new arrangements, produce a further structure of committees that members can see work well within a new governance model. The elements of the overview scrutiny committee were covered by any new governance arrangements. Members were asked to consider what was working well and what key principles of overview scrutiny are important. The discussion gave two lists, one of positive areas of scrutiny and a list of areas of improvements which can be found on pages 73 to 74 of the report. This was followed with questions about developing a fit-for-purpose overview model for Wirral. Two models were presented and they are on page 76. As a result of the members' workshop, several crucial findings were gathered. In discussing the potential models for committee or hybrid systems, there was an agreement that retention of the following key principles and efficiency should be required in any new governance model to ensure decision making is effective, efficient, and legitimate. And they were six particular points that were brought up. Openness and transparency. Members should be able to access all necessary information required to inform the supervisor, with open debates and the ability to challenge, preserve, then model grants. Ensure effective oversight. Budget and performance scrutiny and monitoring should be contained in order to ensure that there is an effective oversight financial matters, delivery of programme works and improved outcomes for Wirral's residents. Holding partners to account. Well, a company delivers a number of services with and through partnership organisations. So it's essential to the positive aspect of the partnership oversight company in order to get scrutiny functions carried over and the independence of this monitoring is maintained. The use of task and finishing scrutiny groups for its decision-making committee is welcome, however, was ensured that the subgroups are truly effective. They will require a focus of improvement and the organisational culture of the authority, ensure that pre-decision scrutiny remains at the forefront of the council agenda, and that all members are proactive in horizon scanning and way of planning. And when we say that, it means that everybody should look at the forward plan every time it's presented by our officers to us to see what is required to help with coming. It's something that most members of the look on the plate and send away. Five, the effective assignments of members with appropriate knowledge and skills across both groups to relevant committees and subcommittees. I think that is just something that is taken for granted that all members have an inbuilt need and desire to work for the benefit of their own communities. The last one was continue engagement with stakeholders through the attendance at committees as internal and external witnesses in order that their views and opinions of residents, staff and partners are taken into account as part of the decision making process. The innovative approach of reality check visits is also encouraged as an important way of ensuring the online engagement. I think that's something that's great to be missed in the past. Members of the authority who sit in the top floors of this place would like to know what the feedback is. Thank you. On to the recommendations that were made on page 77. This is our view of scrutiny. One, the findings of the review of scrutiny arrangement be considered as part of any new government model. The six key principles of effective group uniformly included within the new model of the city committee. Two, the effectiveness of the government's grouping agents for the new government's model should be reduced after 12 months to ensure the good practice currently in operation is continued. And three, the new government's model should ensure full consideration of Wirral's involvement in the local city combined authority over green street functions. That's the recommendations that you made.
Thanks very much for that, Dave. And I've got to say it was a very in-depth report from and I'd expect nothing less from the business to the community council sat on yourself as well. A few things that I picked up on. I think quite a bit of it will feed into what we're about to speak about in the next item anyway. But one was point 72 on page 63, which was to do with partner organisations and members of voiced their concern about that to me with regards to potential change of governance for which is the monitoring of partner organisations, something that needs to be inbuilt in whatever should it happen, whatever the new form of governance may look like. I don't see any reason why that would change anyway, to not actually co-op people onto Liverpool City region as well as ones that was mentioned. So that I don't see any reason why that would change.
Yeah, but it's something that needs to be highlighted. We're going to change the organisation in Wirral. So it's something that needs to be highlighted because we are going to change the way the organisation works and we must make sure that that's in place. There are 2 points that I would like to raise in the main relation. The report itself is comprehensive, as you say. There are certain items in it in relation to decisions made by cabinet and they agreed. The report it says they agreed with all the recommendations that went forward. That's only from the date that was in the report. I know at least 2 recommendations that were made to cabinet that have not been implemented. I can't tell you who you
are. Feel free to share if you want. Okay, the other thing was on page 73, which I think is a reasonable suggestion as well, which was, and it's something that we've spoken about in our own workshops, which is tasking finish groups and also the need for calling potentially, and that's something that if and when a change does happen, obviously that would have to be looked at in the structure, but I think it's something that certainly needs to be considered. Are there any comments on those reports?
Only to thank him for that on the committee for the very detailed report, which is helpful.
Thank you. Janette? Just to say, fact, don't you? I know she recently did a really good job, and I chaired on 2 years, and I know it can be like, tough. I agree with your the points around changing culture. You have to get every member on this council of all persuasions to, you know, for want of a better phrase, pull the thing around and do their bit. Because she recently does. Provide an invaluable service. So thank you for the report, it needs really well.
Thank you.
It's a suggestion that when the minute is published or the document covering what we're discussing on this item and the other ones are published, that is it possible to take the summary and findings and recommendations that Commissioner Mitchell has outlined to us and cut and paste them across on the page. As an appendix or an addendum so that all members have it handy to refer to in the meeting.
That's pretty reasonable, a decent suggestion. Anyone else?
I just want to say thank you as well. Also, the attention was paid to the Liverpool City Region scrutiny, which is essential. It's very important that every members who are within the cross party.
The recommendation is for the committee to recommend to full council that the recommendations of the business scrutiny arrangements are in, approved and included in any new governance model. Do you might have a proposal? Jill seconded. Are we all in favour?
Yes.
Okay, that is agreed. Thank you very much, Dave.
Thank you.
Next item of business is on page That's all the pages of the report. 159, which is item 6, and that is the governance review. So, I'm not going to whittle on about this too much. I think everyone's listening to me on numerous occasions at the workshops, etc. We've spoken about it in depth at other scrutiny on other standards committee meetings as well. But I will say everything that I've come to conclude is on page 175 to 177, which was in my report to this committee. Just a couple of the threads that have actually been present by going through this process, I would say, and some of it ties in with what Dave's just been talking about, which is accountability, credibility, and transparency, and the importance of not just keeping it the same every change, but improving it, and improving all three of those items, so that the people actually elect us and put us in here, see that we are doing a good job and they can hold us to account. I think that is of paramount importance, but also something else that came up, which is collaborative working. And if we're 100% hand on heart, honest, I would suggest that the current form of governance I've come to the conclusion doesn't actually endear people to work that collaboratively. And I think if we do approve the proposal this evening, I think that move forward with a different change of governance, a different form of governance, I think we have an opportunity to make a genuine change to how the council is actually run and oversight that we have as members. So the only other thing, yeah, I think that what David mentioned, openness, transparency, information to be available is one of the things. And I know that there's members who've been told in the past that, you know, basically go and love yourself almost was the words used, I think, and that is something that cannot be allowed to happen. And again, if we can eradicate that and have a more inclusive way of working, if a change of governance is what it needs to provide that, then so be it. So, to say some words on this particular item.
So, my name is Chair. Obviously, the centrepiece of the report is that of the working group, written by working group and penned by the Chair. What I'm trying to do in the covering report is wrap that around that with some of the practical implications that were put before you so that those are.
Thank you, Chair, and I will make some comments if you don't mind on the report and on the work that we did. The first thing I'd like to do is to thank the other members of the working party. I was a member. It was good to work in such a. We were speedy. We really did knuckle down, and we did a very good and central piece of work. Also, the all-member workshop, which was well attended, and although some people did have concerns, obviously about. Any change and how that would look. Overwhelmingly, members who attended declared that they were in favour of change, not against change, not resisting change. They recognised that things move, times change, and certainly the way this council is constructed has changed. So I felt that was helpful as well. But I'm going to go back to the reason for the original notice of motion and look at that, which was that we had there was an overwhelming feeling on that in that debate that decision making on the council had not been of the top quality that we're looking for, and in fact even in the face of fairly strong public opposition, that decision making hadn't been revisited. Now I'm not blaming any individuals at all for that. It's the system I think has took us down. With the, first of all, the cabinet system, but then more importantly, the strong leadership model, which was, I was going to use the word imposed, and I think imposed is the right word, I won't say inflicted, but certainly we didn't have a say in this, it was given to us, we had to do it. And that strong leader model with the delegation of decision making led us up the wrong road, and we do need to have a look back. So our starting point when we set out with the working group was not to say, how can we get to a committee system from where we are now? The starting point was very much, how can we reverse that process that has been going on for some years? And that's where we are. So I think that rather, I mean, obviously I agree with the recommendation of the working party. They were talked about at constraints of the time were too tight. The most important thing would be that the decision had been made by council. So there is no problem with the decision being made by council, as I understand it, correct me if I'm wrong, as I, in the 14th of October, to move towards the committee system. If then the time, you know, the timeline is too tight, it stays for 5 years. That decision stays in place for 5 years. So we could possibly, if need be, and I wouldn't want to see that, but if it was absolutely necessary, that time of implementation would be extended. I hope I'm correct in saying that, and correct me if I have got that wrong, but that's how I read the information we had from the beginning.
Any questions?
I think what I was trying to say was, if the council decided in October that they didn't want to implement the system until May of 2021, there couldn't be another vote in the meantime to
So,
if in October the council had followed the recommendations here and said this system will be in place for May, it would be in place for May.
Right, okay.
Would be no more
okay. I mean, I would like to see it in the place, and I do think it's possible to do that, and I think you've agreed that it is possible to do that, but there's a bit of a safety net there. The other thing that was raised, and I do think we do need to address it as best we can, is the cost of any change. And I have heard it said, I mean, we've got some estimates, fairly broad scope there in the estimates, between 70 and 200,000. But even then, I think that Andrew from the LGA did say even 70 felt rather more than he thought it would be in cost. I think we as a working group were very clear. We didn't anticipate it leading to any increased cost in members' allowances, and in fact, that it could, once we got a structure there that we were able to work with, lead to a reduction in members, in cost of members' allowances. So that's helpful as well. And the rest of it is ongoing, but with fewer committees than the 12 that was in place under an old system of committees. I think we need to work with that. And I have also heard it said this is about democratising, turning to a more democratic approach, and actually sometimes you have to pay to do that, and that does need to be taken into account. I've also heard about it leading to slower decision making, and that implies that decision making previously was quick and effective, and I would challenge that. I would say it could well have been quick, but it hasn't been effective, and if we've forgotten the strength of feeling of some of the decisions, then we probably need to go back and look at the paper headlines of the last 12 months, 18 months, 2 years, to see just how many times things were got wrong. And we don't want to just move on to that as possible, and carry people with us, and so restore credibility to the council. Sorry to interrupt, but that was my thoughts through the process.
Thank you, Moira. That's my job, wasn't it? I think you just put a few thoughts into my head. I think the first thing that came from the all-member workshop, and it was pretty well attended, I was expecting a major defence of the cabinet system from members, and it really wasn't. I think there were many people who were vociferous about having a committee system. At that point in time, whilst I was leaning towards a committee system and having a concrete position, to be fair, but I didn't hear anyone or anything that made me think that staying as we are was the right option. And I was expecting someone to actually give it some defence, and it just wasn't there. Which says that to me that I think most people, the majority of people, have accepted that something needs to change and needs to give. With regards to the old committee system, I don't think it will be anything like what the old committee system was. I think the working practices around the council, also some of the responsibilities and the interlocking working with outside partners is completely different than what it would have been when you last had the committee system. So I think it needs to be as streamlined as possible. I do agree with something that Dave said before, which came up with their review, which was about having the right people in the right places, which is, again, going to be a difficult one to achieve. 7 months from October, in fact. I know it is tight, I think it's doable. I think if it wasn't doable, I would have expected that. The head of governance and law and whatever else you all couldn't do, governance and assurance, would have actually vocalised that to us by now. So I think it is doable. I think the words that Phil used last time was we will have a workable workable constitution in place. It may need tweaking, but again, that's something that Dave's review actually mentioned, that it needs to be reviewed. I would say, not even on an annual basis, something for my bad work is continuous improvement. It what needs continually reviewing, and that's something we should be doing as a committee anyway. So whilst there will be something in place, I'm sure we can actually improve it on an ongoing basis. And other than that, I think that was about it. There was something else, but I forgot, I'll come back to that. Yes, it was also
the comment was about cost. Cost in terms of doing this is, from the officer's perspective, members of the amateurs aside, takes three layers. So the first is implementing a change and the constitution, that's a one-off hit, doing that. The second is in terms of the number of meetings and where those meetings are and how many committees you have. So inevitably, councils coming to a committee system end up employing one or two extra democratic services officers. The other is in terms of the change in committees, so that takes up some more officer time. So quite a bit of the cost that's included, and that's why it's such a wide range. And I would argue some of it in their finger and sticking it in the air, is because of all the costs of opportunity costs. So for example, if I disappear for 3 weeks and write new papers, it's a constitution. That's an opportunity cost back here. So it's things like that, which is why it's that kind of range and a great deal of guesswork from government and CFPS.
Can I just
workshops, it's probably, I would say, a little bit more aligned now than what it was maybe even if you look at my report, it actually leave the implementation dates open. I didn't say the implementation dates, but as Vicky used to say, the reports and the draft of my